Hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and I welcome you to this series called RBI 24/7. So guys, in this series, as you know, we discuss a set of 5 questions, but today we are going to do something different. We are going to discuss about one topic without going for any questions, right? So this is a topic which is very important for your knowledge if you are preparing for competitive exams. So I hope you will find it beneficial. And now let's not waste any time and move straight away to the topic. So the topic that we are going to discuss is RCEP, that is Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, right? So this is one topic which has been in news for past some time, and it has been very hot, right? So because see, why is it so important? Because it comprises of so many countries, and India has been going through such turmoil with many of its neighboring countries. So that is why we need to understand that what is the impact that is going to be there on its economics, on its business, on its industries, right? So whenever governments, they take one decision, there isn't a single impact, but there are so many impacts. So there is basically a ripple effect, that one thing gives birth to another thing, right? So here we are going to discuss different aspects of India not being a part of RCEP, right? So let's start with the session. And before doing that, I would like to ask you guys to subscribe to our channel. So if it is the first video you're watching of our channel, then do not forget to hit the subscribe button, and pressing this bell icon is going to help you to get notified whenever a new video comes up, right? So do not forget to subscribe and press this bell icon. You can also join our Telegram group, on which you can post all your doubts and queries, and we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible, right? So now, beginning with the session. Okay, first of all, talking about what is in the news, or what is currently the news that we should talk about, or what is so special about this RCEP. See, RCEP is nothing but a group of countries which are coming together, and they are saying that we are going to cut our trade barriers to minimum. That is, we are not going to put many taxes on each other, or we are going to have a good trading environment, a good business environment, where our goods and labor can move easily from one country to another, especially the goods, right? So that is RCEP. So 15 countries have joined this group on November 14, right? 15 countries. But India is not part of these 15 countries, because India has preferred to stay out. So India was one of the negotiating members, the initiating members who was there conducting all the discussions. But since India didn't find this deal fruitful for itself, that is why it preferred walking out rather than being a part of this group. So we are going to discuss that, what are the factors that led to India's exit. So this deal has been signed without India. So India's stance was based on a clear-eyed calculation. So Indian regulators, they are saying that their decision is based on calculations, and they have analyzed the costs and benefits of this deal of being there in this group, and they do not find it beneficial for the country. Or you can say the costs of being there are higher than the benefits that India will accrue from this deal, right? So that is why they have preferred to stay out. And this has created the largest trading bloc in the world. So this is one very important factor. Since there are so many countries involving, such big economies like China, Japan, Australia, right? All these countries are there, part of these 15 countries. So this is going to be the biggest trading bloc in the world. Because if you add the size of all these countries, you will find that out of all the different agreements, right? So it can be the North American agreement, or it can be the European Union, right? If you compare RCEP with these kind of groups, so these are also groups of countries who have come together to reduce their trade barriers, right? So if you compare RCEP with these countries, you're going to find that RCEP has the largest size in the world after US withdrew from the TPP, right? So here you can see RCEP. It was launched in 2012 between 10 member ASEAN bloc. The full form of this is Association of Southeast Asian Nations, right? So this is a group of those countries which lie in the southeast part of Asia, and they have formed a group, or they have formed they have come in unity so that they can all benefit from this group, right? Along with the countries which are not part of this bloc, like China, Japan, South Korea, Australia, New Zealand. So these are the 15 countries, 10 countries part of this group, right? Part of Association of Southeast Asian Nations, and rest 5 countries. So earlier it used to be in 16, there used to be 16 countries by adding India, but India withdrew, right? So deal includes 2.1 billion people. See, Asian markets or Eastern markets are considered to be emerging markets by Western nations, because they believe that these are emerging or developing countries where living standard of people, it is rising at a fast rate. So that is why if we go there and offer our products, there are high chances of those products getting accepted, because people are going for buying new products and services, right? So in India also, if you compare the lifestyle of an Indian middle class household 20 years back and now, you come and with now what we have, right? So there is going to be a huge difference. So Indian middle class have adopted gadgets at a very fast rate. They have become more consumer driven. They prefer to buy branded clothes. They prefer to go out and eat in restaurants. So basically their living standard has improved a lot. So that is why this trading bloc RCEP, which comprises of so many people with so many countries, so any country which has access to such markets is going to have benefit, because their products can easily reach to these new markets, or they can explore new markets, right? So 2.1 billion people, RCEP's members accounting for around 30% of the global GDP. So all the countries, 15 countries part of RCEP, their share of global GDP is 30%. So if you add them up, the share that each one of the country has, you are going to get around 30% of the entire world's GDP. Right, so that means RCEP is kind of a big deal, because it will offer so many benefits to all the countries who are part of this group. But still India has not joined it, and what are the reasons, we are going to discuss about it, right? So moving ahead, okay, here you can see the composition. So the 10 nations part of RCEP and the other nations which are not part of Southeast Asian Nations, but it is part of RCEP. These are the 5 countries, right? And these three countries not part of Southeast Asian Nations, and 4 countries part of Southeast Asian Nations, they used to be in TPP also. So Trans-Pacific Partnership. So guys, I'm not going to tell you about TPP. This is kind of a homework for you, that you have to study it on your own. So it is not very important from the point of view of your exam, but still if you give it if you learn about it briefly, then you're going it is going to improve your knowledge of the geopolitical ties all over the world, right? So this was also in news when US dropped out of it, right? So collect information about this, right? So I hope now you are clear about the composition. Moving ahead. Okay, why RCEP? What are the benefits for the nations who are part of this trading bloc, right? First purpose, the major purpose of this bloc, as I told you, is to improve the business relationship, right? Let us learn some more. Okay, purpose of RCEP, making it easier for products and services to move within the countries, or to move among the countries, to be available across this region, right? And leaders are hoping that this association or this unity is going to help all the countries to recover on a faster rate from all the devastation due to coronavirus, right? So RCEP is expected to eliminate a range of tariffs on imports, as I just told you. And after that, also includes provision on intellectual property, telecommunication, financial services, e-commerce and professional services. So e-commerce has already been in news. If you remember, India put a tax on the e-commerce companies, which was not being accepted by companies very easily. So it contains rules on all these relating to all these sectors and all the emerging sectors like e-commerce, right? So it has different set of norms. So under RCEP, parts from any member nation would be treated equally, which might companies in RCEP countries an incentive, which might offer companies who are working in these countries an incentive to look within the trading region for suppliers, right? So guys, see, after a long period of globalization, so globalization, it provided a lot of economic development to many countries all over the world, right? But if we look at trend of recent past, like with if you look at the trends of recent 2-3 years, you are going to find that countries are becoming more close than they used to be, right? So countries are moving away from the trend of globalization, and they are somewhat adopting protectionism, looking for the benefits of their own country first and then thinking about their neighbor, right? So this trend of protectionism has been growing recently. But this type of trading blocks, they put the focus on mutual development, or on they put the emphasis on collective development, that all the countries, they are trying to grow together. They're not trying to cut each other's ways, but they are trying to have benefit which can be enjoyed by all, right? So many times in many countries, there are restrictions on a product that has been produced in a specific country. So products in which country they are originating, that is also very important. But in this trading block, raw materials can belong to any country from the block, and it is not going to be a problem, right? So if there is a company which is working in Japan, right, it is working in Japan, and this company working in Japan is buying the raw materials from China. So there is going to be no problem for it to buy the products from China if it can buy it at a cheaper rate, because both of the countries are part of the trading bloc, right? So basically clearing the way for the movement of products, and these products, they can be raw materials as well as the finished products. Okay, now coming to the problems that India is facing. Why has India not agreed to join this bloc if there are so many benefits associated with it, right? So our regulators, our government, they must have also looked at these benefits. So there have to be many reasons, or there have to be many strong reasons for them not to join the bloc, right? So the first reason that comes out is China factor. This refers to the fact that RCEP is majorly backed by China, or you can say that it is a way for China to expand its global power, to expand its economic power all over the countries which are part of the bloc, right? So India is thinking if it joins the bloc, then it is going to be an addition to the power of China on all the countries, right? So this pact is seen as an extension of China's influence in the region. Escalated tension with China. I think this topic needs no introduction. The problems that have been going on between India and China, Indian government, they are on a spree to become self-reliant. They want to cut their dependence on China for raw materials or for any other product, right? So India thinks that, Indian government is thinking that, that on one hand we are trying to become self-reliant, and on the other hand, if we join this bloc, that is going to be beneficial for China, because it will become easy for China to transfer its products all over the countries who are part of the bloc, right? So they might not be able to cut its dependence after it joins the group. So, major issues that were unresolved during the process of RCEP negotiations were related to the exposure that India would have to China. So, as I just told you, India is fearing the exposure that it might have to China once it joins the group. India withdrew its last year over concern about cheap Chinese goods entering the country, though it can join at a later date if it chooses. So, India has the option to join later, but currently it withdrew. Raise alarm about market access issues, right? So I think in our sessions also in RBI 247, we have discussed it many times how Indian government has taken so many steps to prevent China's entry into sectors like pharmaceuticals. So pharmaceuticals in India, Indian pharmaceutical sector is quite developed, is quite huge, but it is dependent on China for the raw materials or APIs as we know them, right? So basically, once India joins this group, then these sectors will be open to China more, and Indian government might not be able to block its entry, block China's entry, right? So one factor is the presence and the power of China in this group. Moving to other factor, which is possibility of being a dumping ground. So it has its roots in the first factor only, that not only China, if we see India is, Indian government is saying that if we become more open, then it might be possible for all the other countries to sell their products in India at cheaper rate. That is going to harm the local manufacturer, and that is going to benefit the seller country as compared to us, right? So this process of dumping, I hope you remember the meaning of dumping. It has been discussed in one of our previous session. So dumping means just a product which is surplus for a country. That country is selling that product to another country at very cheap rates just to create a market there. Right. So India might become a dumping ground for many countries, especially China, if we open ourselves to all the countries. Right. So there were inadequate protections against surges in imports. And one major problem here is that if so many products start entering our country, then our imports will rise, and if our imports will rise, then obviously we have to pay for them. That puts pressure on the currency. Apart from that, it harms the domestic industry, right? So there are many interrelated problems here. So protection, there are no not adequate protections. And fifth, there could also be a possible circumvention of rules of origin. So guys, if you do online shopping, you must have noticed many websites now, they have put up that this product that we are selling is made in this country, this is made in Indonesia, this is made in Vietnam, or this is made in India. So websites or the sellers, merchants, are specifying the country of origin of their product so that consumer can make an informed choice, right? So Indian government, it fears that if we allow ourselves to join this group, then these rules might be circumvented or these rules might be misused, and many products which should not enter the country might easily get into the country. So apart from that, India's experiences with FTAs means free trade agreements. So we have discussed the meaning of FTAs in one of our previous session. So I hope you all are aware of it. FTA, briefly, it means an agreement between different countries in which they decide to reduce their trade barriers so that they can have a more buzzing business environment. So India's experience with FTAs or the agreements that it already has with many countries has not been really good, and it has not earned much benefit from it. That is why Indian government is doubtful here. Moving ahead to the next factor, which is trade deficit with many member nations. So see, undoubtedly Indian government is working to increase the exports, to push the domestic manufacturing and to reduce the imports. But currently, out of these 15 nations that are part of, that have recently joined RCEP, India is having trade deficit with many of the countries. Here you can see it is having deficit with 11 out of 15 countries of RCEP, which means that in case of these 11 countries, India is importing or buying more from these countries than they are selling to it. So we are buying more and selling less. That obviously puts pressure on our budget and also on our currency. So this trade deficit point is very important. This has been cited by as the major point by Indian government to behind the decision of not joining RCEP. So some experts feel that India has been unable to leverage its existing FTAs with several RCEP members to increase exports. So many experts, they say that India already has agreements with many RCEP members also, and still it has not been able to push its export. It is still importing more than what it is exporting. So it might be possible that RCEP benefits other nations more than it benefits us, more than it benefits India. So China alone has a huge debt over India. So stance on the deal comes as a result of learning from unfavorable trade balances that it has with several RCEP countries. Here you can see in the next slide. Okay. Here you can see that how much is the import and export of India with these member nations. Okay. China, you can see imports are so high as compared to exports in all the countries, South Korea, Australia, Japan, New Zealand. In all the countries, imports are higher than the exports. That means India is buying so many goods from these countries, but it is not able to sell products to these countries. And this is the total of all the 10 members of association, right? Here also imports are higher. So you can see the debt burden on India is so high, and it might increase if India joins RCEP. Moving ahead, here you can see. Okay. Next factor, loss to domestic industry. Obviously, if we allow easy entry to so many products, if we allow easy entry to so many products from all these member nations, then it is definitely going to harm Indian industry. And there have been many protests, especially in the textile sector, in the dairy and agriculture sector. So guys, if you remember in the session where we talked about Bangladesh, we discussed how Bangladesh has been pushing its textile industry, and many companies that are thinking of shifting their supply chains from China to other nearby nations, they are thinking of going to Bangladesh or other smaller countries like Vietnam or Indonesia. So these countries might eat up India's share in the global trade if we open up to them or if we provide their products access into our country. So that is why considerable opposition with major stakeholders like farmers, dairy industry or corporate sectors. These sectors, they have been protesting against India's entry, India's joining into RCEP, right? Okay, here you can see some industries which are considered vulnerable by Indian government, which can be harmed in case India joins the group, right? Agriculture, industrial goods, textile. So, moving ahead. Okay. One more factor, why is India not joining RCEP? And this factor is India's unfulfilled demands. So as I told you, India was one of the negotiating members of RCEP, right? So also if you Google the member nations of RCEP, you're going to find many pictures in which there is presence of India. That is because India was being considered as a very important member, and many countries like Japan and Australia, they desperately want India to join the group. But because India put so many demands and these demands were not fulfilled, that is why the non-fulfillment of these demands has been one factor behind India not joining RCEP. So here you can see the demands that India put: shifting of base year for tariff cuts from 2014 to 2019, so that they become more transparent. The calculation of tariff, it becomes more transparent, more up to date with time. Import surge. So India wanted some sort of mechanism that will prevent Indian imports from rising too much. So it wanted some auto trigger mechanism, but it was not made available to India. It wanted rules of origin to be stricter so that customers are aware that the product that they are buying, where is that product being made or manufactured. Services, a better deal in services, because India has a huge share of services in services contribute a large proportion to India's national income. That is why India wanted a better deal in services so that other countries do not eat up our share in case of services. It also wanted RCEP to exclude most favored nation obligations from the investment, especially to countries with which it has border disputes. So India wanted to exclude this rule of most favored nation. So most favored nation, it is a principle and it is a very interesting principle. Why is it so? Because the name tells you most favored nation, a nation that you favor the most. But actually, contrary to its name, this principle stands for equality. It says that all the trading partners should be considered as equal, and the benefits that are being provided to one country should be provided to all the trading members or all the trading countries. So if India is providing one benefit to one, is providing some trading benefit to one of the country in RCEP, then it should provide equal benefits to all the countries. This was not acceptable to India because India has many agreements with some smaller countries of RCEP, according to which India provides some benefits to these countries. And if India joins RCEP, then it would have to provide all these benefits to the bigger members like China also, and that would make them send their products into India without any difficulty, right? So, and the growing tensions between India and China, it needs no introduction. So this non-exclusion of MFN from the principles of RCEP was one major deterring factor which made India quit RCEP. Okay, now what are the costs of not joining this group or not joining RCEP for India? Obviously, joining might provide India with such a big market, right? We just discussed that how RCEP is a very big deal, and it is leading to the, it has actually become the largest trading bloc in the world. So that is obviously very important to be a part of this country, and especially for an emerging economy like India. So what are the costs of not joining? First of all, impact its bilateral ties with RCEP members. Right, I just told you that there are many countries with whom India already has some bilateral agreements, right? So see, let's say for example, we take a country Japan. Let's say India already has some trading agreement with Japan. Now India provides some benefits to Japan according to that agreement, and also receives some benefit from Japan according to that agreement. Now Japan has become the part of RCEP, so there might be some contradictions or there might be some problems with Japan fulfilling all the obligations that are part of the existing agreement between them, right? So it might become contradictory. Sometimes some norms, some rules might become contradictory for the RCEP members, that whether they should follow the rules of the agreement that they have with India or they should follow the rules of RCEP. And obviously, if they ruin their relationship with RCEP or if they ruin their relation, or if they violate the rules of RCEP, they are going to have bad image in front of so many countries. And here, if they do not follow the rules with India, they might ruin their relationship, or they might get into bad books of only one country, right? So RCEP becomes heavier than India in comparison. So all the countries having existing agreements with India, they might tilt towards RCEP's norms, right? So this is one of the major factors. So you can imagine it as a group of friends, right? So let's say there are two friends, and out of these two friends, one becomes the part of cool gang of college, right? One becomes a part here, but one does not want to become a part of this cool gang. So there can be differences between these two friends also, because this friend who is friends with this person, and who also wants to become the part of the gang, that person might have some difficulty in balancing both of the parties. Same goes for countries who are part of RCEP now and who have bilateral agreements with India, right? Okay. Apart from that, it might leave India with less scope to tap the large market that RCEP offers. Obviously, RCEP comprises of so many countries, and if India becomes a part of it, if you are allowing an easy entry to goods in your country, then your products also have an easy entry there. So if India joins the RCEP and pushes its product, it also has a large market to exploit, or it also has a large area to create new markets for itself, right? And India is giving up on that. So size of the deal is mammoth, as countries involved account for about 2 billion of the world's population. So India is going to make it difficult for itself to create a market among these countries by not joining this RCEP. Might miss out on attracting foreign infrastructure. So this is also a very important point. We have discussed about China plus one model so many times in our session, right? So it means that many international companies which are set up in China, they are now looking forward to shifting their supply chains to nearing country, right? So India can exploit that part also, but not being in RCEP taints its image as being closed economy, or as being not friendly, not having amiable relationship with many countries, right? So India might miss out on attracting these foreign companies. And you know how hard Indian government is trying to bring investment into the country. Many states like UP, many South Indian states, they are trying to get massive companies of the world to set up their factories, to set up their offices in their states, right? So India might miss out on that. After that, okay. So countries like Japan and Australia, they really want India to join the group. And the negotiators from Japan, they have also vouched for India that if India wants to join at a later day, it can join RCEP, right? So it might be possible that there can be chances that all the countries with whom India has good relationship, friendly relationship, it might put those relationships into threat, right? And the group of countries called Quad, which has recently been in news a lot, comprises of four countries: India, Japan, here you can see India, Japan, Australia, and US, right? So US is not a part of this Asia Pacific RCEP. So these three countries are having good relationship. India has recently invited Australia to join them with their military exercises, right? So this group, which is going good, there might be some threat to the relationships of these countries, right? India's decision could impact the Australia-India-Japan network in the Indo-Pacific. See, because Because if you look at the political map of the world, US is a country which is towards west, but all these countries, they are not very far away from each other. They are part of Asia, they're part of Indo-Pacific. So it's important to have good relations with the countries which are geographically near to you, right? So might put these relationship in jeopardy. Negotiators from Japan worked hard to keep RCEP agreement open for accession by India, and they also said that India may participate in RCEP meetings as an observer. So this is a very important point. Although India has not joined the group, but it can attend the meetings as an observer just to keep a check on what's happening, right? So this might provide India with many insights which can be useful for it. So there's a saying that if you do not want to be on the menu, you should be on the table. So this role of India as an observer justifies that. Okay. Now, what are the ways ahead? Okay, we are not joining RCEP, but what can we do now to improve our infrastructure, to improve our attraction for the world's investors, right? So India has an option to join without having to wait for 18 months. That is usually the rule for a new entrant into the RCEP group, right, according to PAC. But India will not have to follow that. India has been provided a special status in that sense. So apart from that, India should review its existing bilateral agreements. Okay, we are not part of this multilateral group, but the bilateral agreements that we have with different countries, we should review it and try to do a cost-benefit analysis that whether they are profitable to us or not. And if they are not, then we should find out a way to get rid of them, right? So, and it should find out a way that all the agreements that it has with the RCEP members, that it should not create any disruption for these countries, or India should find out ways to not to taint their relationship with these countries, right? As well as newer agreements with other markets with potential for Indian exports. Apart from that, apart from these RCEP countries, India should look for new markets as well for its own exports and try to push the export. And for pushing the exports, it is very important to give Indian manufacturing a push. Right? So India currently has agreements with members like the countries part of Association of Southeast Asian Nations, South Korea, Japan, and is also negotiating with members like Australia and New Zealand. Right? So these are some ways that can help India out to develop without joining RCEP. So guys, this is it for today, and I hope you found this session beneficial and informative for you. And if you did, then do not forget to hit the like button and do subscribe to us, because I'll be back in next session with some more information. Until then, you keep watching and keep your studies carrying on. Take care of your health. I'll see you in the next session. Thank you for being here.